Topic number 21, Grow Leaders Fast. One of the training programs that we offer companies to help them get to world class in their market space is called Grow the Leader. Organizations all around the world, including NASA and pharmaceutical giant Bayer, are using our unique process to increase employee engagement, enhance culture, dramatically boost performance, and produce superior business results. Grow the Leader is based on a simple yet powerful concept. The ultimate competitive advantage of your enterprise comes down to a single imperative: your ability to grow and develop leaders faster than your competition. The more quickly you can get every single person in the company demonstrating leadership behavior, regardless of their position, the more quickly you will lead the field. Your race is to grow leaders fast and develop a culture of leadership before your competition does. A leadership culture is one where everyone thinks like an owner, like a CEO or managing director. It's one where everyone is entrepreneurial and proactive. This means they focus on getting to solutions rather than on problems. This means they do whatever it takes to keep customers happy. This means they worry about sales and do their part to reduce cost. This means they take personal responsibility for achieving results that move the business forward. This means they shape culture, stay positive, and lead by example. We have helped our clients create leadership cultures, and the results have been nothing short to remarkable. I pray that I have been clear. I'm not saying everyone needs to do the job of a CEO or managing director. Showing leadership doesn't mean every employee will run the organization. That would lead to chaos. Business do need someone to set the vision and then lead the team to it. All I am suggesting is that all the people on your team need to know their role and then show up fully in that role like a leader would. And when they do, when they think, feel, and act like leaders, good things will happen, and soon your organization will get to great. Number 22. Your 4-minute mile. The philosopher Arthur Schopenhauer once observed, "Most people take the limits of their vision to be the limits of the world. If you do not, join them." Profound point. The life that you see this very moment isn't necessarily the life of your future. You might be viewing things through the eyes of your fears, limitations, and false assumptions. Once you clean up the stained glass window you see the world through, guess what? A whole new set of possibilities appears. Remember, we see the world not as it is, but as we are. That idea changed my life over a decade ago, when I was an unhappy lawyer searching for a better way to live. Before 1954, it was believed that no runner could ever break the 4-minute mile barrier. But after Roger Bannister broke it, many more replicated his feat within weeks. Why? Because he showed people what was possible. They got a new reference point, and then, armed with that belief, people did the impossible. What's your 4-minute mile? What bill of goods have you sold yourself as to what's impossible? What false assumptions are you making in terms of what you cannot have, do, and be? Your thinking creates your reality. Your beliefs truly become self-fulfilling prophecies. Because your beliefs drive your actions, and you'll never act in a way that is misaligned with your thinking. The size of your life reflects the size of your thinking. If you think something cannot occur in your life, then there is no way you will take the action required to make that goal a reality. Your impossibility thinking manifests itself. Our perceived limitations become the chains that keep you from the greatness you were meant to be. And you are so much better than that. Celebrated neurosurgeon Ben Carson expressed it so well when he said, "There is no such thing as an average human being. If you have a normal brain, you are superior." Chapter number 23. Push the envelope. How big do you dream? How fast do you move? How relentlessly do you innovate? I think of Apple on the subject of innovation and their devotion to offering the world insanely great products. I just bought my daughter an iPod. She was extraordinarily persistent in her asking, "Smart kid, such an array of iPods to select from. The Shuffle, the incredible sleek Nano, the U2 version of the iPod." Rather than resisting on its laurels with the massive success of this product, Apple just keeps innovating, reaching for something even better. I did a speech for the Young President's organization the other night, talked about leadership and how the best get better. Shared how companies can achieve stunning success by making a few simple changes and course corrections. One young entrepreneur came up to me for a chat. I asked him for the best idea he's learned for winning. Always be pushing the envelope, he replied. Sure, being a leader is a lonely act. The very definition of being a leader means you are out in front with no one else, taking the road less traveled, taking responsibilities for results in a world that loves to blame and deny responsibility, seeing possibilities that no one else has yet dreamed of, challenging the way things are. If you were in a herd, thinking and behaving like everyone else, then you wouldn't be a leader, you would be a follower, and that's no fun. So, push the envelope, refuse to accept anything remotely close to mediocrity. Let go of the chains that you have bound you to the ordinary, and definitely leave the crowd. The only place you will reach if you follow the crowd is the exit. Stand for your best. Commit to excellence, become massively innovative and wear your passion on your sleeve. They might call you different or weird or even crazy, but please remember, every great leader or visionary or brave thinker was initially laughed at. Now they are revered. Topic number 24. On obituaries and the meaning of life. I'm 41 years old, so I'm at off time. Assuming I live until I'm 80, and that's a big assumption because I've learned that the only thing you can expect in life is the unexpected. I'm halfway home, halfway through the adventure I call my life. I've become more philosophical these days. I'm less willing to waste my time, less willing to listen to negative people, less willing to miss an opportunity to be loving, champion another human being, get closer to my dreams, or have some genuine fun. I've also started reading obituaries. When I read of the lives others have lived, I'm offered clues on what's most important in life. Obituaries of lives well lived actually share consistent themes. I've discovered family, friendships, contributions to community, the need to take calculated risk, kindness through small simple acts, and love. I went to read an obituary that says he died peacefully in his sleep, surrounded by his lawyers, his stockbroker, and his accountant. No, the great ones all speak of being close to loved ones and of the impact the deceased had on the world around them. To lead a beautiful life, I suggest that you need to ask the kinds of questions that will provoke you to think deeply and connect with what matters most. One of the dominant traits of so many of the extraordinary people I have worked with as a success coach is the discipline of being more reflective than most of us. So ask profound questions. Good questions lead to excellent answers and greater clarity. And greater clarity is the DNA of authentic success and personal greatness. Here are 5 big questions that I hope will cause you to go deep and become more philosophical about what truly counts in your life. Most people don't discover how to live until it's time to die. But by then, it's too late. Ask yourself these 5 questions today. Write your answers in your journal. Talk about them. Think about them. Imagine that today is the last day of your life and you are lying on your deathbed. Then ask yourself, did I dream richly? Did I live fully? Did I learn to let go? Did I love well? Did I tread lightly on the earth and leave it better than I found it? My hope is that the answers you arrive at will help you live with more authenticity, passion, and joy. Clarity really does precede success. You can't hit a target you can't even see, and we are really not here that long when you think about it. We'll all be dust before you know it. So, live your potential now. The Chinese says it so well. The best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago, but the second best time is today. Number 25. Leadership isn't a popularity contest. is an idea that just might transform your entire career and your life. Being a leader isn't about being liked. It's about doing what's right. So many leaders are afraid of conflict. They have deep-seated need to be popular and cherished. They hate ruffling feathers and making waves. They are insecure and not so comfortable living in their own skin. But great leaders are different. They fearlessly make tough calls. They speak their truth. They run their own race, making the right decisions and worrying little about public opinion. They are courage in action. I speak and write a lot about being caring and respectful to people. Treat your people well and they will treat your customers well. That's a no-brainer. Help people get to their goals and they will happily help you to get to yours. I'll take that value to my grave. See the best in people and be the most compassionate person you know. But being kind doesn't mean being weak. Being a human doesn't mean that you don't need to be strong and courageous when required by the circumstances. Not once have I ever suggested that. Extraordinary leadership is a balance between being tender yet tough, compassionate yet courageous, part saint and part warrior, friendly yet firm. All that the best leaders really care about is being fair, doing what's right and getting results. And that brings me to my gentle suggestion to you. Do the right thing rather than doing the popular thing. The best thing to do is generally the oddest thing to do. Please remember that. Make the tough decisions. Speak with candor. Let underperformers know when they are underperforming. Tell your superstars how much you love them. Just be real. When you lead from a position of truth, justice, fairness, and excellence, you are your critics. Who cares? I never seen a critic show up at a deathbed. My friend Dan Sheehan, who runs a great company called WinPlus out of Los Angeles that we have done leadership development work with, once shared this with me. Great people build monuments from the stones that their critics throw at them. Nice point. Smart guy. If I had listened to all my critics, I would still be an unhappy lawyer locked to a desk. Thank God I didn't. What do you evangelize? Being an evangelist has negative connotations in the world we reside in. But an evangelist by definition is simply someone who spreads good news. It's someone who gets stuck on a big idea or a passionate cause and then walks out into his day and spreads the message like a virus. It's someone who gets so engaged in doing something important that it's all he thinks about, dreams about, talks about. It's a human being who understands at a cellular level what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. meant when he said, "If you have not discovered something you are willing to die for, then you are not fit to live." This troubled and uncertain world of ours needs more evangelists. Human beings doing great things, blessing lives by their action, making a difference. Where did most people's passion for greatness go? Each of us had it as kids. We wanted to be superheroes, astronauts, poets, painters. We wanted to change the world, stand on mountaintops and eat lots of ice cream. Then, as we aged, life began to do its work on us. Fearful people snickered at our dreams. Disappointments began to show up. Life began to hurt us and we began to buy into the propaganda that says, "We should not think too big, reach too high, and love too much." Breaks my heart to think about it. But that's exactly what happens. You are meant to shine. I believe that fiercely. You are here to find that cause, that main aim, that vital destiny that will move you at the most visceral level and get you up at the crack of dawn with fire in your belly. You are meant to find something that your life will stand for, that will consume you. Something so beautiful and meaningful that you would be willing to take a bullet for it. It might mean developing people at work and helping them live their highest potential. It might mean being an innovator who adds outrageous value to your clients and brings cool products to the world. Your cause might involve elevating communities or helping people in need. I recently read about a lawyer who said he was so passionate about being of service to a group of victims he was representing that he wouldn't give up until there was blood coming out of his eyes. Extreme, Maybe an evangelist, definitely. I'm an evangelist. Talk to anyone who knows me and they will tell you that my obsession is helping human beings lead without title and getting organization to world class. Sure, I have my downtimes and odd days. Find me someone who doesn't. But mostly, you'll find me full of enthusiasm, high energy and delight at spreading my message. Am I more special than you? Absolutely not. I've just found my cause. I don't know what your life's most important to-do is. That's for you to figure out. But I do know this. When you find the mission that your life will be dedicated to, you will wake up each day with that fire in your belly I mentioned. You won't want to sleep. You will be willing to move mountains to make it happen. You will find that sense of internal fulfillment that may now be missing from your life. And you will preach that message to anyone who will listen. You'll become an evangelist. Number 27. Under the kimono, my best practices. I just want to help you shine. All I really care about is doing my part to help you get to your greatness, to help you reach your best at work, to help you find happiness at home, to help you make your mark. What's my payoff? Well, when I help you live your finest life, I get to feel significant. I get to feel that I am making a difference in the world, that I matter, that I am not walking the planet in vain. That's where so much of my happiness comes from, truly. So, here's what I thought about in the shower this morning. What are my best practices? In other words, what are the best things that I do to stay at my very best, on game and in potential? Here's what I came up with. Up at 5 a.m. 5 times a week with naps on the weekends. A 60-minute holy hour once I am up for self-development and personal reflection. 5 big-time workouts a week. A 90-minute massage every 7 days. A world-class diet. A period of journaling most days. Journaling builds self-awareness. I also use my journal to write daily goals, plan, and record what I'm grateful for and capture and process new ideas along with lessons learned. A period of reading each day. Affirmations or what I call success statements throughout the day, especially in the shower. This keep my thoughts locked on what's most important, and thoughts are the ancestors of actions. Right thinking drives right action. A weekly planning session. I also review my goals here. Usually I do it Sunday morning. At least one conversation with an interesting person each week to keep my passion high and to surround myself with big ideas. A single conversation can change your life. In an issue of Business 2.0, management consultant Jim Collins revealed that one idea shared in 30 seconds by a mentor transformed him. I have more, but these are my best personal practices, the ones that bring out my highest. Pick up the ones that resonate with you. Discard the ones that you disagree with. Just find what works for the way you live, then act on them today. This very day can be the first day of your new life. It's all your choice. Chapter number 28. Culture is King. At a leadership training program I recently gave for a group of high-tech managers, a distinguished-looking man came up to me at the break and shared, "I love what you said about the need for each one of us to develop a leadership culture within our organizations. At our company, one of our top priorities is to work on our culture. We talk about it all the time. Last year, our company grew 600%. Our focus on culture building worked splendidly. Impressive. As I've suggested earlier, one of your most suitable competitive advantages will be developing a culture of leadership. When clients engage to Sharma Leadership International for organizational development and employee training, one of the first areas we focus on is developing the company's culture. Because all performance is driven by the culture. Your competitors will copy your product if they are good. They will copy your services. They will copy your branding, but they will never be able to copy your culture. And your culture is the very thing that makes your organization special. Your organization's culture is what sets and then drives the standards of behavior. Your culture tells your people what is acceptable and important. Your culture lets people know what your organization values. Your organization's culture states its philosophy, its mythology, its religion. To me, culture is king. The five best ways to build culture are as follows. Rituals. I love the cult in culture. The best companies like Dell and Google and Southwest Airlines and Apple and the Walmart have something in common with cults. They have unique rituals like 7 a.m. team huddles or Friday afternoon pizza parties to promote team bonding. Rituals shape culture and keep it special. Number 2. Celebration. John Ebel, founder of the multi-billion dollar Boston Scientific, once told me over dinner that you get what you celebrate. Powerful idea. When you see someone living the values your culture stands for, make them a public hero. Behavior that gets rewarded is behavior that gets repeated. Catch people doing good. Number 3. Conversation. Your people become what the leaders talk about to get your vision and values into your people's heart. You need to be talking about that stuff constantly, at employee gatherings, at your weekly meetings, during your daily hurdles and at the water cooler. You need to evangelize what you stand for constantly. In his excellent book reading, Jack Welch said that he spent so much time evangelizing GE's mission that he could call his people at 3 in the morning and off asleep, they could restate it. Number 4. Training. A mission critical focus to build culture is employee development. If you agree that your organization's number one resource is your people, then it only makes sense to invest significantly in developing your number one resource. Hold seminars and have leadership workshops to instill the values you seek to nurture and build a leadership culture into their hearts and minds. When your people improve, your company will improve. Number 5. Storytelling. Great companies have cultures where great stories are told from generation to generation. The story about how the company was found in a basement, or the story about how a teammate went the extra mile and delivered a customer's baby, or the story about how the organization fought back to victory from the brink of disaster. Storytelling cements a company's most closely cherished ideals into the hearts of its people. People want to go to work each day and feel they are part of a community. One of the deepest psychological needs of a human being is the need for belonging. We also want to work for an organization that values us, that promotes our personal growth, and that makes us feel that we are contributing to a dream. Get these things right by creating a culture of leadership, and you will keep your stats and attract the other ones. And wouldn't that be a perfect? Number 29. Your schedule doesn't lie. There is an old phrase that says, "What you are doing speaks so loudly that I cannot hear what you are saying." You can say that your primary value involves putting your family first. But if time with your family is not all over your schedule, well, then the truth of the matter is that your family life isn't your priority. You can say that being in world-class physical condition is another top value, but if I don't see 5 or 6 workouts etched into your weekly schedule, then the reality to be confronted is that your health just isn't an important as you profess it to be. You can argue that self-development is an essential pursuit to you because the better you are, the more active you will be. Show me your schedule and I'll discover the truth, because your schedule doesn't lie. There can be no authentic success and lasting happiness if your daily schedule is misaligned with your deepest values. That's a big idea that has been so helpful to so many of the executive clients that I coach. If there is a gap between what you do and who you are out of integrity. I call it the integrity gap. The greater the chasm between your daily commitments and your deepest values, the less your life will work. Why? Because you're not walking your talk. Because your videos is not congruent with your radio. Because you are committing the crime of self-betrayal, worst crime of all. and the witness that lives within the deepest part of you, your conscience, sees it. Your schedule is the best barometer for what you truly value and believe to be important. Too many people talk a good talk, but talk is cheap. Less talk and more do. Show me your schedule and I'll show you what your priorities are. I used to be a litigation lawyer. Witnesses in the courtroom could say what they wanted to, but the evidence never lied. Topic number 13. Shine as a parent. I've had coaching clients fly their private jets to the small airport near our office in Toronto and show up to our first meeting saying something like, "Robin, I have all the money I will ever need and a bunch of homes scattered around the world along with a ton of public acclaim. But I'm desperately unhappy." I ask why. "Because I lost my family while I built my business. My wife left me and my kids don't even know me. That breaks my heart," is how the reply usually goes. Put your family along with your health at the top of your priority list. Family matters. What's the point of getting to your dreams but being alone? And few things are more important than being an extraordinary parent. Kids grow up unbelievably fast. Blink and they're gone, living lives of their own. It seems like only a year or two ago that I witnessed my daughter's birth. Now she is 9 and spends much of her free time playing with her best friend Max. It seems like yesterday my son was in a stroller with the chubby cheeks of a baby and the sounds of an infant. Now he is 11, reading even more voraciously than I do and sharing his vision for his future. Sure, it's a little sad watching your children grow up so quickly. I guess all I can do is stay devoted to them and be generous with my time. Here are some ideas for you to shine in the incredibly important role of your parent. Number 1. Lead by example. The best way to influence your kids is to walk the talk. Model the behavior you wish to see. Don't preach the beauty of the books and learning and then head your family room to watch 3 hours of MTV. Those little eyes watch everything you do. I talk about this in Family Wisdom from the Monk Who Sold His Ferrari, which is a book that will be very helpful to you as you grow young leaders at home. Number 2. Develop your children. See yourself not just as a parent to your children, but as a developer of them. It's important to actively develop their minds, hearts, and souls. That's your job. Expose them to great art. Take them to interesting restaurants. Introduce them to cool people who produce unique ideas. JFK's father would invite fabulously interesting people to dinner often. During the meal, the Kennedy kids would learn from the guest and then quiz the visitor to deepen their learning. Smart practice. Number 3. Inspire your kids. Big idea. Parents teach their children how to view the world. Parents show kids the way the world works. And if you see the world as a place of limitation, so will those little people you are raising. Try not to teach your fears to your kids. Introduce your children to what's possible. Inspire them to be a great human beings who will elevate the world in their own special way. Be an enabler. Here's a tool for you that comes from my home. Each night before my kids go to sleep, I make 4 statements to them. You can do whatever you want to do when you grow up. Never give up. Whatever you do, do it well. And remember how much your dad loves you. Been doing that every night for 4 years, they often say, "Dad, we know all this stuff now. We know we should never give up and how much you love us. It's getting boring." But I have a sense that one day perhaps when I'm old and wrinkled, a letter will come in the mail from Colby or Bianca, my 2 favorite people on the planet. And on that piece of paper will be a simple word saying, "Dad, I'm living a great life. Thank you for being the father you were. And thank you for those 4 statements each night. They made a difference." 31. Be a merchant of war. Just checked into your Hotel Victor here on South Beach before I wrote this chapter. I saw it being renovated a few months ago and made a mental note to check it out on my next visit to Miami. So here I am, waiting to be impressed, just aching for a reason to tell you something good about this place in a world where so many businesses are boring, slow, and stale. I like trying new hotels when I travel. I observe what to do and mostly what not to do when it comes to customer service, study cool design, and check out whether the hotel understands that in this experience economy we now live in, the customers must be taken on a journey from start to finish that makes them go, wow. Good news, this place is amazing. Big smile when I entered from the doorman and a warm greeting. Ultra cool design inside. Lots of green and fresh colors. Sexy music and vibes. Super nice front desk staff. The smile thing again with a wonderful offer of an Evian water with a slice of lime while I was checking in. And since the MTV Video Music Awards are shooting a video with the killer tonight down by the pool, Karin asked me whether I wanted a room that would allow me to watch all the action. Sure, I don't need much sleep anyway. Eric the bellman showed me the workout facility and then the spa. Best hotel gym I have seen since the Sanderson in London. And the room is awesome. Art deco, impeccably clean and stylishly put together. All very impressive, stunning, actually, which is the standard I encourage you to aspire to. Hotel Victor under-promised and then over-delivered. It had a chance to win me over and through well-trained staff, unique and superbly kept facilities and excellent amenities. It did. Now, I'm going back downstairs to try its food. I bet I'll be wowed. 32. Getting what you want while loving what you have. Some people encourage us to enjoy the moment and appreciate what we have, suggesting that constantly striving for more is unhealthy and the primary source of our discontent. And others say that as human beings, we were built to push behind our comfort zones each day and reach for something higher to become great. I've struggled a lot with this issue as I articulate a personal philosophy that I live my life under. I think I've found the answer, a solution that feels right to me. It's a balance. I've realized. I call it the Mandela balance. Nelson Mandela, a man I greatly admire, once said, "After climbing a great hill, one finds that there are many more hills to climb. I've taken a moment here to rest, to steal a view of the glorious vista that surrounds me, to look back on the distance I have come. But I can only rest for a moment, for with freedom comes responsibilities, and I dare not linger, for my long walk has not yet ended." To me, Nelson Mandela is suggesting that it truly is all about a balance. Enjoy the view from where you are at. Savor how far you have come. Be grateful for where you are along the journey that is your life. Live in the moment, but also remember that with the gifts that reside within you comes great responsibilities. I believe that every human being has a duty to shine. We must not rest on our past wins and become complacent. We must walk out into this world each day and do our best to be of greater service to others, realize more of our potential and become better citizens on the planet. We must continually walk toward our fears and make more of our lives. We must constantly play a bigger game and use our creative talents to do, be and see more. This drive to realize more of our greatest selves as I believe being knitted into our DNA, and to deny it is to deny our human nature. And yes, as we set higher dreams and raise our personal standards, we will create some discontent. But this world was built by people who felt some discontent with the way things were and knew they could do better. Show me a completely contented person and I'll show you a failure. Observed Thomas Edison. Politically incorrect these days, I know, but I think he was speaking truth. The greatest among us were not satisfied with the way things were. Think Gandhi, think Mother Teresa, think Desmond Tutu, think Bill Gates, think Einstein, think Mandela. So, love what you have and then go for what you want. Enjoy the climb up the mountain, but never take your eyes off the summit. Chapter number 33. Think like a CEO. I spoke to the leadership team of Satyam Computer Service a few months ago. Amazing company, one of Asia's fastest growing IT firms. 0 to $1 billion in less than 10 years. 23,000 employees. The chairman is a visionary. I'll share one of his powerful ideas. There are 1,500 top managers at Satyam. They run 1,500 different divisions and functions. So he tells them that they are not really managers. They are the CEOs of their own small businesses. The larger corporation is simply an investor that they need to keep happy. It provides them with resources, structures, and opportunities. They just have to return results. The concept inspires them to take ownership of their functional areas and behave like entrepreneurs. It gets them to act like real leaders. It encourages them to be part of the solution rather than part of the problem. Brilliant. You are the CEO of your functional area. Do you have a finance function at your company? You are the CEO of that area, that small business. Work in human resources? That's your small business. Clean up at the end of the day? You run a cleanup business that serves the larger company you work with. Take personal responsibility for the success of your business. Show up like an entrepreneur. Grow sales, cut costs, get good stuff done. You will shine in your career and the CEO will love you. Number 34. Act like an athlete. One of the best ways I know to create spectacular results in the most important areas of your life is through daily practice. Top athletes know that practice is how you get to greatness. I was in Moscow a while back for a series of speeches and workshops. One morning, I went down to the hotel gym for a workout. It was 6 a.m. Guess who was there? Mary Pierce, the tennis star. For 2 hours, she ran, lifted weights, did sit-ups and countless push-ups. She was paying the price for success. You need to practice to get to your greatness. Athletes know this so very well. Why does it seem so foreign to the rest of us? Sure, practice takes discipline. But, as my friend Nudo Cubin, the business consultant and motivational speaker, often says, the price of discipline is always less than the pain of regret. Wise man. What I'm suggesting is that personal and professional greatness takes work. I would never suggest that you could get to your dreams without having to make some sacrifices and pay the price in terms of dedication and self-control. Pay the price. Words with the ring of truth. The best amongst us make it all look so easy. I call it the Swan effect. Elite performance makes personal and business mastery look effortless and seem to make things happen as gracefully as a swan moves along the water. But, like the swan, what you don't get to see is all the planning, discipline, hard work and near-flawless execution take place below the surface. In my life, I have a series of practices that set me up for a great day. I've shared those with you. Yes, sometimes life sends you unexpected challenges that knock you off track. That's just life happening. But with a series of best practices in place to keep you at your highest, you will stay in positive state much more often. This is a simple yet life-changing idea that has helped so many of our clients. Practices that will lock you into your best state, including your morning journaling session, where you record your feelings, thoughts, and the blessings you are grateful for. Or you may start your day with a strong workout and an elite performance meal. I often listen to music for 15 minutes. As it not only energizes me, it makes me feel happier. I also use success statements or affirmations to get my mind focused. Success and joy or inner peace don't just show up. You need to create them. Find a series of practice, perform them with consistency, and then go out into this beautiful world of ours and shine. Topic number 35. Be wildly enthusiastic. Be enthusiastic. Smacks of the obvious. Be energetic. Sounds trite. Be passionate. Seems boring. Yet, without enthusiasm, energy and passion, you cannot lead your field and an organization cannot get to world class. Ralph Waldo Emerson once said, "Every great and commanding moment in the annals of the world is due to the triumph of enthusiasm." And Samuel Woolman observed, Nobody grows old merely by living a number of years. We grow old by deserting our ideals. Years may wrinkle the skin, but to give up enthusiasm wrinkle the soul. Enthusiasm matters. The people I love to be around are generally those that have a simple or felt quality. They are enthusiastic, wildly so. They are open to life. They are curious. They love to learn. They smile when they see me, and they have a lot of fun. Play odd or don't play at all. Today, show up at work with all the enthusiasm you can genuinely muster. Be outrageously energetic and madly alive. See the best in people. Go the extra mile to delight your customers. See the opportunity for learning and personal evaluation amidst a seeming setback. Embrace change as a chance to grow. Have a laugh with a teammate. Tell your loved ones you adore them. Spread some passion. I'll be the first to agree that you cannot control what happens to you each day, but with an abundance of enthusiasm, I have no doubt that whatever the coming hours bring, you will handle them with grace, strength, and a smile. Number 36. Success isn't sexy. Too many leadership experts make being successful and fulfilled sound complicated. They preach the latest technique and offer the latest modality that they say will speed you to your greatest life. Take a magic pill or try the latest fad and all will be fine. Life will be perfect. Nonsense. Yes, crafting an extraordinary existence takes work. Of course, getting to greatness personally and professionally requires sacrifices. A primary sign of maturity is the ability to give up instant gratification for a much more spectacular pleasure down the road. And true, the right thing to do is generally the oddest thing to do. But here's the good news. With daily, consistent effort in the direction of your dreams and an application of the fundamentals of success, you really can get to the place you've always dreamed of getting to. Success isn't sexy. It's all about working the basic of excellence with a passionately consistency. I love that word, consistency. It's amazing how far you'll get by just staying with something long enough. Most people give up too early. Their fears are bigger than their faith, I guess. Stick to the fundamentals that you know in your heart are true and you'll do just fine. What are those fundamentals? Things like being positive, taking responsibility for your role in what's not working in your life, treating people well, working hard, being an innovator rather than a follower, getting up early, setting your goals, speaking your truth, being self-disciplined, saving your money, caring for your health, and valuing your family. I told you that you already know this stuff. Nike is a client of ours, and they got it right with all that JDI stuff. Just do it. As I wrote in my book, Who Will Cry When You Die? The smallest of actions is always better than the noblest intentions. Don't complicate things. Getting to your best life is simple. Not easy, but simple. It just takes focus and effort. That philosophy about the 1,000-mile journey beginning with a single step is true. Do a little each day to get you to your goals, and over time, you'll get there. Small daily gains lead to giant results over a lifetime. Big idea. Personal and organizational greatness is not about revolution but about evolution. Those small but consistent wins. Sam Walton began with a single store. Richard Branson began with his first little record shop. Steve Jobs started Apple out of his garage. Yay, I started with a few cases of self-published books that I would have printed in a Kinko's copy shop. And only 23 people showed up for my first seminar. 21 of them were family members. Every dream starts small, but you need to start today. Topic number 37. On cuddle parties and the sad state of the world. Get this, I just heard that people across North America are showing up at designated places to have cuddle parties. Strangers get together, introduce themselves, and then spend some time cuddling. Nothing more. just feeling the touch of another human being and feeling connected. The paradox of our weird world is that as we become more connected electronically, we become less connected emotionally. People spend hours each night reading blogs, downloading podcasts, and surfing the internet, but they have forgotten the importance of old-fashioned conversation. They have neglected the power of breaking bread with family and friends, and they have lost sight of the importance of human touch. Do what you like. I am not a judge, but I have no plans to show up at a cuddle party anytime soon. I would rather work to build the bonds of humanity with those already around me by being loving to my kids and other family, kind to my friends and supportive of my teammates and clients. Just doing that would give me all the cuddles I need. Number 38. The value of good. After I gave a speech for a major telecommunication company, a woman walked up to me with tears in her eyes. "Robin, I've read all your books and try my best to live the kind of life you write about. But there was a man who actually lived your message. He died a few months ago. He was my dad." She passed and looked down the floor. 5,000 people showed up at my father's funeral. She said, "The whole town was there. I was so honored to see that." "Was your dad a well-known business person?" I asked. "No," she replied. "Your popular politician?" I wondered aloud. "No," she whispered. "Was your father some kind of a local celebrity?" "No, Robin, he wasn't all that." "Then why did 5,000 people come to your dad's funeral?" I had to ask. Another long pause. "They came because my father was a man who always had a smile on his face. He was the kind of person who was always the first to help someone in need. He always treated people incredibly well and was unfailingly polite. He walked the earth over so lightly. 5,000 people showed up at my dad's funeral because he was good." What happened to valuing being good? Reality TV shows exhibit the worst of human behavior. We see music superstars who swear every 5 seconds. We read about corporate leaders who fill their pockets to buy bigger boats while shareholders lose their life savings. I love the movie Wall Street, but Gordon Gekko got it wrong. Greed isn't good. Good is good. Some people laugh at the notion of being nice and decent and noble. That's a sign of weakness. Nope. It's a sign of strength. Soft is hard. It's easy to put yourself first. It's easy to get angry when someone disagrees with you. It's easy to complain or condemn or take the path of least resistance. What takes guts is to stand for something higher, to behave greater, and to be of service to others, like Mandela, Gandhi. I wish I could be one quarter as good as them. Sorry for ranting, but this is a big topic for me. I'll be the first to tell you I'm far from perfect. I'm just a messenger, an ordinary man. But I'll tell you one thing. I do my best to be good. That quest keeps me up at night, and I hold myself to a standard far higher than anyone could ever expect from me. Do I always get it right? No. Am I always at peace and without anger? No. Do I always model my message? No. I try each day, but I slip sometimes. I'm not saying that treating people with respect means you don't hold them to high standards and expect excellence from them. It doesn't mean you don't use boundaries and get tough when you have to. Showing leadership isn't about being liked by all. It's about doing what's right and what's good. 39. Grace under pressure. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. once said in a speech, "The ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy." So true. What we are as human beings presents itself more fully in times of adversity than at times of ease. Anyone can be positive, polite, and kind when things are going well. What distinguishes people with an extraordinary character from the rest of us is how they respond when life sends one of its inevitable curves. They don't crumble or surrender. they reach deeply into themselves and present even more of their highest nature to the world. Just a couple of hours ago, I went on the runway, ready to fly home from London. The flight had been delayed by a few hours, so it felt good to be so close to takeoff. I had my iPod in place, a new book to read, and my journal. Then, the pilot's voice came over the public address system. The ground crew has found a metal instrument in one of the tires. We regret that we must cancel this flight. The reactions that statement provoked were fascinating. One man close to me became belligerent to a flight attendant. A couple in another row grumbled loudly. A businessman in a dog suit actually kicked the seat in front of him. Yet, some passengers responded differently with a quiet humanity. An elderly gentleman smiled as he helped others take their bags down from the overhead compartments. A teenager, rather than trying to rush off the plane like most of the other passengers, stopped to help a woman with a disability. The lady sitting next to me laughed and said, "Hey, it's not the end of the world," before calling her kids and sharing her adventure with them. The wisest amongst us have a remarkable ability to maintain grounded when times get tough. No life is perfect. Mine certainly isn't. We all must face challenges, both large and small. This very minute, somewhere in the world, there are parents dealing with the death of a child. This very minute, someone has suffered an accident that will devastate their loved ones. This very minute, there are human beings dealing with illness in a hospital bed. Sickness, loss, disappointment. No one gets through life without experiencing this stuff. But you and I have the power to choose to rise above our external circumstances. We always have the choice to be strong and positive when things fall apart. We have the right to use our stumbling blocks as stepping stones to our greatest life. This isn't motivational sloganeering. I believe this is truth. Grace under pressure, that's what separates leaders from followers. It's the beautiful quality that inspires others and reflects as well developed spirit. It's a trait that allows you to carve out a spectacular life, one you will be proud of at the end. My seatmate was right. Things could have been so much worse. I'm safe. I have my health. I have two wonderful children. I have work I love and so much to be grateful for. Sure, I now have to wait a few hours to catch the next flight home. Maybe I'll get started on that book my editor keeps asking me about. Chapter number 40. To be more productive, relax and have more fun. Spending all your time working will not make you more productive. In my experience, and I've been at this for over 10 years, few people get their best ideas at work. I invite you to take a moment to think about it. Checking your email messages on your BlackBerry every 60 seconds will not make you more effective. Burning the candle at both ends doesn't tap into your natural pool of creativity. Refusing to take vacations will not make you a star performer. Here's a big lesson I've learned. I get my best ideas, the thoughts that have really elevated my business and revolutionized my life, when I'm relaxed and having fun. There is a great value in making the time to chill out and do the things that fill your heart with joy. Newton didn't come up with this breakthrough observation on the laws of physics while rushing to catch a subway. Einstein spent a ton of time sailing and connecting with his childlike self. The creator of the sewing machine came up with the idea while dreaming about an island native holding a spear with a hole in the end of it. I came up with the old concept behind leadership wisdom from the monk who sold his Ferrari, the 8 rituals of visionary leaders, while taking a long solo drive out in the country. When the idea hit me, I pulled over onto a dirt road and downloaded the ideas into my journal for more than 2 hours, an unforgettable experience for me. I often joke with my audience that I make most of my income on a skiing. People smile, but they get my point. You need to make space for your genius to flow. We get our creative buzz, those idea torrents that take our business and personal lives to the next level. while we are skiing or drinking coffee in a Starbucks or walking in the woods or meditating with the sunrise. Those pursuits are not a waste of time. No way. Those pursuits are a superb use of your time. Creativity comes when you are relaxed, happy and enjoying the moment. And when it comes, it can bring ideas that rock your world. All it takes is one good idea to get you to previously unimagined results. Relaxing, taking vacations and making time for fun actually make you more successful. And these pursuits make you money. Mireille Guliana, the CEO of Killcote, said it well. We have to take beach time, a space for ourselves every day, because we live in a world of burnout. Even if you take 20 or 30 minutes for yourself, you'll be a better worker, a better colleague, a better person. It benefits the people around you as much as it benefits you. Get this, Hewlett Packard recently noted that constant interruption of technology actually took 10 points off the IQ of an average employee in a work environment. And the US software firm Veritas saw something amazing happen after it introduces email-free Fridays. Friday became the most productive and creative day of the week. So, have some fun. Laugh with your co-workers. Go for a walk at lunch. Go fishing or swimming or golfing this weekend. Maybe sit on a beach for a week down in the Caribbean or visit the great museums in France and Italy. Or just take a nap and relax. And if anyone tells you that you are wasting time, you have my permission to say, but Robin told me I'm being productive, and then go back to sleep.